just had never even known there was a problem. We had deaths, numbers of deaths. Last December, we had 3 in 1 week, including my husband's cousin freezing to death on a road in Iowa after a wreck. We've had physical and mental illness, Graves' disease, neurocardiogenic syncope, I can tell you later what that is, and anxiety, depression, suicidality, multiple hospitalizations. And then the loss of both of our jobs, and finding out that just in case you ever agree with your employer that it's best on both sides for you to leave your job, and they tell you that they'll help you with getting unemployment, just know that if your reason is illness, that doesn't work. If a doctor doesn't tell you to leave your job, you will not get unemployment, which is what we're both experiencing now. And we've tried to sell our house and had months of delay. And we had an offer right away that was great, had months of delay, and only to find out that the gentleman who was going to buy our house went into the hospital, found out that he has 6 months to live. So, of course, we're praying for him and trying to see what the Lord has for us with this house sale, because right now that's still on us, that monthly payment every month. So reactions, you know, all this stuff happens and keeps happening. It definitely, the roller coaster has not stopped. At first, I would say angry at God, blaming God, saying, you could have stopped this. You're all powerful. Why in the world would you let all of this fall apart? And thinking, I'm cursed. I screwed up too much. He doesn't love me anymore. I'm out of favor with God, and he has turned his back on me like others did. And thinking, I'm not worth much of anything. So of course, you know, you have all those lies that come into your head when stuff's going wrong. Thankfully, the Lord does not leave us there. We have incredible friendships and amazing family. My parents are amazing. We're staying with them now, and that's been fun. Brett's parents have helped us immeasurably. We have an incredible safety net, and I praise God and thank him for it, because I know without it, we would be in a homeless shelter. That's just our reality. You know, we have a roof over our head, we have food to eat, we even get to go to Starbucks here and there, you know? And the biggest blessing of all has been the Word of God, because the Lord has completely altered my perspective through the course of all these events. The first thing he taught me is it is okay to grieve. Even if everything is going to turn out okay, that does not detract from how horrible it is to go through some of this stuff. And it is not a problem to say, God, this is horrible. And to have people come around you and just agree with you, this is horrible, feels amazing. I can't tell you how many times the friends that I have, the ones that just would come sit with me and say, this is really awful, that meant so much. I had friends cry with me and it meant so much. And the Lord showed me in his word how he wept with Lazarus' family, even as he knew that he was about to go raise him from the dead. He knew it was about to all turn out for God's glory, yet he cried with that family in their grief in that moment. He met them in the moment. He sweat blood in the garden, saying, let this cup pass from me. Even though he knew he was going to rise victorious in 3 days and save all of us, yet he sweat blood as he was going through all of that agony before he knew what he knew was coming. He also taught me that it was never supposed to be like this. We were supposed to be in a perfect garden. We were supposed to be in perfect community with him. We weren't supposed to have all this brokenness. But, you know, sin happened. Thank you, Adam. And, you know, we're in a very messed up world. And things happen. Things go wrong. You get sick. You know, it happens. But like I said, through all that, though, we're surrounded by so much love, so much, so much care. It's just amazing. He just taught me that we need to allow ourselves room to grieve and to mourn what's going on. Like it says, in Romans 12:15, and not rush what the Lord is doing. This was a huge one for me. Not to rush and say, oh Lord, fix it now, fix it now, fix it now. To understand that there's more going on than just what you perceive in your suffering. Only he knows his reasons, only he knows his plan. The best thing that we can do if somebody's suffering is just grieve with them and help them understand that you see it. You see how horrible it is. And know that he grieves alongside of us too. He is grieving with us as we suffer. The second thing he taught me was that to live, that the whole point of life itself is Christ. His purposes, his reasons for his glory. Philippians 1:21, for me to live is Christ and to die is gain. I had always thought a lot about the second half of that verse. I had not thought as much about the first. And understanding that everything that we go through has purpose. Luke 9:24, for whoever would save his life will lose it, but whoever loses his life for my sake will save it. And then this was another one, John 10:10, the second half. I have come that they may have life and that they may have it more abundantly. I've learned that that abundance is not riches, it is not my pleasure, it is not happy, pleasant experiences or blessings like we often think of them. These sufferings are huge blessings. I had errors in my thinking. So yes, you told me to live, to really live is Christ. It's not my pleasure, not my happiness to live is Christ. And that every experience we have is part of the story that he has already written. Ephesians 2:10, for we are his workmanship. Tammy Smith, in her excellent book, Soul Healing, says that we're handcrafted by God. We are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. Romans 5:3-5, not only that, but we rejoice in our sufferings, knowing that suffering produces endurance, and endurance produces character, and character produces hope, and hope will not put us to shame because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit who has been given to us. Before these experiences, I did not understand suffering as well as I do now. I did not have the same view of the poor as I do now. I did not have the same view of those who are hurting, and also those who say, I have an illness, and they don't really look all that sick. I have a far greater understanding now of what that's like. The Lord has softened my heart. He has softened my heart so much for these things, and I really believe now, if we're still on this earth, then it's because he still has good works for us to do. The story's not done. So regardless of what you experience, it is all part of the story. He knew it was all gonna happen. It's written into the good works that you're supposed to do. And that provides purpose. So my husband and I have talked a lot about Job 13:15, the first half. And it's kind of become the battle cry. It's, though he slay me, I will trust him. It doesn't matter what comes. It doesn't matter how much more falls apart, because it's part of what he's doing. To live is Christ. He has his reasons, and his reasons are good. Thanks for letting me share.
Thank you.